Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Jesus Christ, our Lord, make us worthy to celebrate the feast of your Ascension. We raise our pure hands to you in prayer, our chaste souls to you filled with grace, and our sincere hearts to you with love. We yearn for that place to which you have ascended, so that with the host of angels we may glorify and thank you, your Father and your Holy Spirit, forever. Peace be with the church and her children. Let us raise glory, honor, and praise to the one who came into the world from the Father. He was hanged upon the cross, buried in the tomb, and raised from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. To the good one be glory and honor on this feast and all the days of our lives and forever.
Amen.
O Christ, by your ascension, you ended your stay on the earth, completed your plan of salvation, and returned to the Father to prepare a place for us, so that we may be where you are. You taught us the way to the place where you were going, and you told us to follow you. When Thomas asked you, "We do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" You answered, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Now, O Christ, our Savior, we ask you with the fragrance of this incense to walk with us on the way that leads to the Father. Turn our eyes toward him, strengthen our desire to be with him, and guide our steps that we may reach the Father through you and with you. And we praise you, your Father, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
As the Lord, the King of Judah,
priest who was priesthood and Christ's ascension, laying hands upon the heads of his apostles, he said to them, go and make disciples of the world, baptize them in faith, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one true God. I ascend now to the right of God, my Father. Hallelujah.
Jesus Christ, our Lord, receive the fragrance of this incense that we have offered to you on the feast of your ascension into heaven. Grant that we may prepare ourselves to receive the Holy Spirit, whom you promised to send to us. May we take the places that you have prepared for us in the presence of the Father and meet you in the heavenly kingdom. We praise you, your Father, and your living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen. Shat Hayanato no Kodi Shat no Mahayuto Mishimo Kode
King of glory, and who is this Lord of hosts? He is God, strong and mighty, King of glory, Lord of hosts.
Lord God, you accepted what I trust and offer you. Now accepting your mercy, I will sacrifice and
a reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Ephesians. Glory to the Lord of Paul and the Apostles. May the mercy of God descend upon the reader, the listeners, and upon this parish, your children forever. Therefore, I also, upon hearing of your faith in the Lord Jesus and of your love for all the saints, did not cease giving thanks for you, being mindful of you in my prayers. That the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and of revelation, resulting in knowledge of him. May the eyes of your hearts be enlightened, so that you may know what is the hope that belongs to his calling, what are the riches of glory in his inheritance among the saints, and what is the surpassing greatness of his power for us who believe. In accord with the exercise of his great might, which he worked in Christ, raising him up from the dead and seating him at his right hand in the heaven. Far above every principality, authority, power, and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. And he has placed all things under his feet, and he gave him as head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of the one who fills all things in every manner. Praise be to God always. Savior announcing life for our souls, we offer this incense and ask for your mercy, O Lord. Shlomo Elokol Chunam. From the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Saint John, who proclaimed life unto the world. Let us listen to the proclamation of life and salvation for our souls. And Jesus said, now is the Son of Man glorified, and God is glorified in him. And if God be glorified in him, God shall also glorify him in himself, and he shall glorify him at once. My children, I shall be with you only a little while longer. You will look for me, and as I have told the Jews, there where I go, you cannot come. And so now I say this to you. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. So you should love one another. This is how all men shall know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. This is the truth. Peace be with you.
Grace and blessings to Jesus Christ, our Lord and God.
Now shall the Son of Man be glorified, and God shall be glorified in him. In the name of the Father, of the Son, of the Holy Spirit, amen. Around the year 115, St. Ignatius of Antioch, the great patriarch, was killed in martyrdom in Rome. And we have actually a good number of writings, considering it's the very beginning of the church. He knew as a child, knew of the apostles. So St. Ignatius of Antioch writes a series of letters to the churches as he's being dragged along off to the city of Rome. He writes to a number of the churches. They're very famous. But he writes on other things also that we have still from his writings, from his teachings. And one of them is on the Ascension, which is actually quite fascinating because it's a way of looking at the Ascension, you know, in the early 100s of the tradition of the church. Remember a few weeks ago or last week or whenever it was, a couple weeks ago, I mentioned to you that you should read the scriptures, but read the scriptures with the fathers, what they're commenting on. We call them the fathers because they are witnesses to the ancient traditions of the church. And so it's true, you may not get through much of the sacred scriptures text, but in a half an hour, those two lines, the two verses that you read will be so much richer a part of your life. What St. Ignatius does is he is part of, being Antioch, the influence of the Semitic tradition, Aramea, out of which Beit Marun comes, right? What we call the Jewish converts, that Semitic vision. And amongst the things that we have in these early commentaries are our Lord's descent and his ascent. And they have, depending on who the writer is, they can have quite a detailed description of whether you're using a cosmology of three heavens or of seven heavens and our Lord's descent. But what number of them seem to strike on is that the descent of the Word to the womb of the Blessed Virgin Mary, to enter among in mankind, to work the salvation of humanity, that it's unknown to the angels. And that's why in Psalm 23, where you have these verses that say, raise the gates, who is this Lord of majesty? You hear it echoed in our Mazmuro. So the Mazmuro is that little hymn of three verses before the readings. And you'll see, if you read it again, you'll see it's echoing Psalm 23. Who is this Lord of hosts? Who is this Lord of glory? Open the gates, raise them up. And what the fathers are using in the very beginning of the church is they're saying, because the angels themselves, and especially the fallen angels, St. Ignatius of Antioch makes it very clear, Satan doesn't know anything about the virgin birth, doesn't know about the birth in Bethlehem, does not understand these things, and doesn't understand who this person is until he dies. And then in his death, the power that shatters through the dominion of death, he knows what he's done. St. Peter will say this in the Acts of the Apostles, that if they had known the Lord of glory, they would not have put him to death. And so the principalities, the dominions, all of this, these unusual terms that we have in the scriptures and in the epistle today to the Ephesians. And St. Paul, when he says that our battle is not with flesh and blood, it's not people who are our problem. It's the powers and the dominions and the principalities of the air, of this world of darkness. And so St. Ignatius takes this whole image then, is that for the demonic who do not have the beatific vision, who do not have the faith, the descent of our Lord, the incarnation within the womb of Mary of Nazareth, his birth, the angels sing, but the demonic doesn't know what's going on, the darkness, the principalities of this air. He says it's all hidden to them, and so that when it's time for our Lord's ascent, there is a shock to them. So what you wind up having, who are these powers and the gates and the principalities, are the shattering, it's the reaction of the powers of death and of sin in this world, of creation, that are in shock. Who is this Lord? When he says, who is this Lord of hosts in our Mazmuro? Host means armies. Who is this Lord of power that ascends? Who is this triumphant majesty that ascends amongst all of creation. And remember, we've mentioned this oftentimes, the ascension is not that our Lord just takes off on a cosmic journey. It's not they just wait and wait and wait and wait. It is a transformation and a transposition from this world to the right hand of the Father. What the ascension is the glorification of the resurrection, but from the viewpoint of the Messiah himself personally. So he goes through this ascension and is glorified at the right hand of his Father with the glory that he had personally as the Word from before the foundation of the world, that his humanity is brought into this glory that has always been his, that he set aside, making himself poor, making himself fragile, as the beautiful second chapter of the letter to the Philippians recounts. So St. Ignatius emphasizes this aspect of the confusion of the demonic, and that part of the resurrection is in the glory that is shown, that the unbelievers are put to shame. It's why when the devil tempts our Lord in the desert, the very beginning of the three-year ministry, he says, if you are the Son of God, change this stone into bread. If you are. He doesn't know. He knows what Israel believes. And he knows that these things that you call scriptures, he knows those texts. He didn't believe in them. You meet lots of people who know that Jesus rose from the dead. But it means nothing to them. They don't believe in it. That gives you an example of the principalities and the powers and dominions. They do not have the faith. They do not believe. They know the words, but it means nothing to them. So when the realm of death and sin is shattered, then they know who the Lord of glory is, not because they believe, but because they feel the effects of redemption that they are not part of, and it is oppressive to them. So you have St. Ignatius of Antioch taking this letter to the Ephesians also, in chapter 3, not in this one that we read today, but when he says that it's through the church that the mysteries of God, that the mystery of redemption is announced, and that even the angels learn of what the plan of redemption is through the church. Because the church is Christ in his body. That's the reading we have today. That it's in his glory of being raised up that God places him as head of the church, which is his body. And it's in that reality of the Christ on earth, the church, that even the celestial realm of the intelligences learn the plan of redemption. It's quite an extraordinary thing. And St. Ignatius is extolling the very reality of what the church is. That the church is even the vehicle for these intelligences, even in the obscurity of their lack of faith and of their sinfulness, that come to know what the plan of redemption is. This is a vision you don't usually come across in your little spiritual readings, unless you're reading the Fathers. But such a depth to weave the Ephesians, the Psalms, all together with the Gospels of what is the day of redemption. You know, on the Ascension itself, we read from St. Mark, and it talks about our Lord accompanying the disciples, confirming the word that they preach with signs that follow. So our Lord accompanies them, but the word is announced by the church. So St. Ignatius is pulling in St. Mark that we had on the Feast of the Ascension, pulling in the letter to the Ephesians, pulling in Psalm 23. There you already have your spiritual reading for the week to read the Gospel of St. Mark. Once again, as we had on the Feast of the Ascension, to read the Psalms. Psalm 23 is part of what we call the Psalms of Ascent. Ascent with SC and not two S's. Because they're the section of the Psalms. And you remember, when you think about the Psalms, they're just hymns. And the Psalm, the Psalter, right? The collection of the Psalms, all 150, it's a hymn book. And as you have in any hymn book, you have a section for Easter, you have a section for Christmas, you have a section for Advent. So does the Psalter. And so there's a section of the Psalms that are the Psalms of pilgrimage, of going up to Jerusalem. This Psalm 23, to raise your gates and to receive the Lord of glory, they come in Psalm 23, come from those Psalms of the Ascent. And if you ever have a chance to go to the Holy Land, if it ever settles down again, which it will, because it goes through convulsions regularly, so it will calm down also. Read the Psalms of Ascent when you're outside Jerusalem, as you go to Jerusalem. And when the first psalm starts out, I look to the hills to find my salvation. And then you have the hills of Judea around you as you go up. That's why they're called the Psalms of Ascent. Jerusalem is on a hill, but Jerusalem, by what she is spiritually, is always higher than everything else in creation. You always go up to Jerusalem. And so Psalm 23 of the raise the gates to receive the Lord of glory. These are psalms that would have been done also with the carrying of the Ark of the Covenant in procession, to raise and receive the Lord of glory. So there's a lot of things that are interwoven here through the scriptures, through the testimony of the fathers of the church, that give you a full sense of why the Ascension is a holy day of obligation, right? Why it is that we pause on that 40th day last Thursday in order to celebrate what is not just simply part of the plan of redemption, but we can actually say is the summit. And so the same way that the Ascension of our Lord, he doesn't just simply leave and leave and leave and leave and leave until he gets really tiny. And then he disappears because they can't see him anymore. You'll notice that the Acts of the Apostles says he ascends and then the clouds cover him. And so the apostles could no longer see him. That aspect is that transposition, that Passover. All of this movement is Passover. It's Pesach, Pescho in our Syriac. It is a transposition from a world of sin to the glory of God. It is lived out in the reality of the Word of God incarnate, hidden from the angels, received by the angels in ascension. But the reality that is shown is the very movement of the redemption of mankind so that there where our Lord is, we may be. Read the opening prayers of this Mass of the Ascension again. Read the beginning of the Husoyo. The grace that we ask for is to change us, to transform us, and give us the desire to be where you are. You can be assured that if our lives were continually inspired by this desire to be with our Lord at the right hand of the Father, not in a sentimentalistic or a kind of emotional vagueness of something called heaven like in modern culture, but truly a desire to be in the glory at the right hand of the unseen Father, in the Christ and with Christ. When you read the letters of St. Paul, he goes on and on again about Christ in us, us in Christ, that we are in Christ, Christ in us, that the whole purpose of the ascension, that culmination, is that he promises to us, I go to prepare a place for you. And the gospel that we had today from St. John is from the Last Supper. It's actually the moment when Judas leaves to betray our Lord. And he says, now the Son of Man is glorified. And if he be, and God is glorified in him, and if God be glorified in him, he will glorify him at once. It happens now. And every time grace comes into our lives, this is a transformation, drawing us towards that right hand of the Father, if we allow it. To the degree, and this is the last point and really the application of this whole thing, we can stand in adoration and in admiration of what happens in our Lord's life, and we should. But it's meant to actually indicate something to us that we are also meant to follow, that you follow me, right? So in the Husoyo today, they have St. Thomas's question. We don't know where you're going. How are we possibly going to follow you? And our Lord says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And we ask for this, and it says in the Husoyo, you follow me. How do we follow our Lord? It's the imitation of our Lord, the imitation of Christ, the pursuit of virtue, the extirpation from our lives of sin and the mistakes and the faults and the self-centeredness and the blindness that lead us so easily, because it's our default mode. Leave us alone on our own, that's what we go to. Self-centeredness doesn't necessarily always mean a mortal sin, but it is always blinding. And so when our Lord says, follow me, become what I am. Follow me. I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. Everything comes together in this Feast of the Ascension and of these days of the Pentecost that we pray during these days of the Novena to prepare for the coming of the Spirit. All these things, again, are in your little red books. Go back and look at these texts again. They're very point by point, they are there. So the last point that I want to leave you with then is, why do the principalities and the powers and the dominions have no idea about the incarnation? Why do the principalities and the powers do not recognize the virgin birth or even recognize who this rabbi is? Because they're blinded by sin. They are in their nature pure intelligences, right? They're the same beings as we call the angels, the same. And how can you have pure intelligence that remains so dark? And we could even say in modern culture, so dumb. Why are they so stupid? The scriptures tell you what is going to happen. Because they do not have the virtue of faith. So they do not see. And in seeing, they remain in darkness. And so the application here for us as we celebrate these days of glory is that to the degree that sin is part of my life, I am blinded. It's very simple. There's a simple logic in it. To the degree that I allow sin, not just gross mortal sins, but to the degree that I allow even those venial sins that people usually brush off and say it's not important, they are important because they are detours and they are even to jeopardizing a derailment of the path to follow our Lord. So to the degree, because the division between the valley of tears, between the city of God and the city of man, runs through the heart of every single one of us. And we always kind of balance back and forth. Sometimes there's faults and sins. Sometimes we pray piously. And we open ourselves to the redemption of grace. But we waffle. Now hopefully as we get older, we waffle less. That's the idea. But it's always to understand that even among the saints, even when St. Teresa of Avila, when she would sin, because even the great saints aren't impeccable, except for the Mother of God and our Lord. So the faults will come in, even if they're inadvertent faults. There will still be mistakes that take place in all of us. But Teresa would always, in her prayers then, when she would confess these sins before the Lord, she would say, "That's Teresa for you, Lord." She was never shocked by it, but she always wanted it rooted out. There was always the desire to follow. And so for us as an application, our examination of conscience is to say, where are the shortcuts and the cutting of corners that I do in my life, even at the smallest things? What are the aspects of my life that are not penetrated by the divine light of faith and of virtue and of grace? And where are we, what am I doing to actually begin to curtail that, so that I am completely open to the vision of Lord, so that when the Lord God of hosts, when the Lord of glory appears within me, to me, at me, in grace, I am ready to open the gates and to receive him in glory. It's a very simple idea, but it's the work of a lifetime. Not easy, but certainly worthwhile. Because to the degree that we enter out of that darkness and to see with the Lord of glory, the more that we will be free, and the more that we'll be at peace. So on this day, may the penetration of light and glory be truly convicting to us, to convince us of what our Lord is trying to do in our lives. And then plunge yourselves now into what is the third day of the Novena, to pray for the power of the Father, the promise from on high, to receive next Sunday on Pentecost. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. We believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and all things visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us sin and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate through the Virgin Mary,
saying he was crucified with Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the scriptures. He is ascended to heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no limit. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is the Lord of the Lord. Let us look into the prophets.
We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins,
and we look forward to the resurrection of the dead and life of the world.
Itanot madem hedaloho, alvotalo chodam padetayant, vainam sugo taibuto, keon alvaita fescudem hayat lo, or koda shochem. Almighty Lord and God, you accepted the offerings of our ancestors. Now receive these offerings that your children have brought to you, out of their love for you and for your holy name. Shower your spiritual blessings upon them, and in place of their earthly gifts, grant them life and your imperishable kingdom.
Amen.
As we remember our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ and his plan of salvation for us, we recall upon this offering all those who have pleased God from Adam to this day, especially Mary, the Blessed Mother of God, Saint Joseph, her spouse, the Chosen One, our Holy Father, Saint Mary, Saint Jude, and Saint Epiphanius. Remember, O God, the children of the Holy Church, our fathers and mothers and our brothers and sisters, both the living and the departed, especially those for whom this sacrifice is offered, for the intentions of all the members of this parish. Remember also all those who share with us today in this offering.
Amen.
Alleluia.
Alleluia.
We will continue with the anaphora of St. John Marin on page 897. 897. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Good and holy God and Father, through your only Son, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, you have prepared the spiritual and holy banquet for us. Accept these pure offerings and grant us the gift of your Holy Spirit. Make us worthy to approach your sanctuary with pure hearts and clear consciences. Grant us the peace that your only Son gave to his holy disciples, so that we may give one another that same peace with a holy kiss. We raise glory to your only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace to you, O holy altar of God. Peace to the holy mysteries placed upon you. Peace to you, O server of the Holy Spirit. Let us give the greeting of peace to our neighbor with love and faith that are pleasing to God. Peace. O Lord, may your peace and security and your love, grace, and divine mercy be with us and among us all the days of our lives, that we may raise glory to you, to your only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
O Lord, we bow before you and ask that your merciful right hand rest upon your servants, who are here before your majesty. Mark us with the sign of life, that we may raise glory to you now and forever.
Amen.
The love of God the Father, and the grace of the only begotten Son, and the communion and indwelling of the Holy Spirit be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your spirit.
Let us lift up our thoughts, our minds, and our hearts.
We lift them
to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord with reverence and worship him with humility. Father of mercies, Lord of creation, Lord of the universe, unsearchable God, you are the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, your beloved Son, born of you and equal to you. He is the radiance of your glory, the image of your being, and by your power, the maker of all. In him you created the world in your grace. In him we see you, and from him we receive your Spirit. In him the mystery of the Trinity, hidden from all ages, was revealed. We praise and we thank you with our mouths that have been blessed by your word and cleansed with your forgiving hyssop. Those who glorify you are countless. Cherubim and seraphim saw thousands of spiritual beings standing before you, and myriads of fiery ranks serving your majesty. They sing triumphant hymns with harmonious voices. O Lord, although we are your weak and sinful children, make us worthy through the gift of your grace to sing with them and to proclaim. Glory to you, God the Father, who will be exalted on the human nature of your grace. And in your abundant mercy, you sent your beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, into the world. He came down to us. And by the Holy Spirit became flesh of the Virgin Mary, accomplishing all things for our salvation.
Thank you.
Kuri eleison, Rabiamo hodoctum hashodi lema ben faye, and some lahma mida, Kuri shanto, O barahu kadesh, Waksoya bilitalimita, karamaram, Sabahulamene kulukul, O non denita. Fahoro dila dahlo paikun wahlav sagie metahaseu metiem usoyon hame wa hoyin an hailam alamin. Kanna walukun santam zikho min hamro min mayo Barakhu kadesham Uyabin talmitao karamara Sadashtawa mehne kulkun Hono denitao De modila dianti kichadato, dahlo faikun wahlav sagiem, mete shedu metihel, usoyon hame wa hoye dan kailam alamin. Do this in memory of me. But whenever you gather in my name and eat this bread and drink this cup, you remember my death and resurrection until I come again. You suffered and endured for us, and your liberating and life-giving plan of salvation, your miraculous incarnation, your saving passion, your life-giving cross, and your life-giving death, your solemn burial, your joyous resurrection, your ascension into heaven, your sitting at the right hand of the Father, and your second coming when you shall reward all people according to their deeds. O Lord, have compassion and pour out your mercy upon all of us, that we may enjoy the gifts of your heavenly church. For this your church implores you, and through you and with you, implores your Father, saying,
have mercy on us, O Lady Father. Have mercy on us.
O Lord, as we, your sinful children, receive your graces, we thank you for them and because of them.
We praise you, we bless you,
revealing the place of glorious light, and your Holy Spirit come, descend and rest upon this offering.
And we
pardon us, forgiveness of sins, and for those who share in us.
Manin Murio, Manin Murio, Manin Murio, Nite Moroho Hayo Kadisho.
Amen.
mysteries, may sinners be absolved and enemies be reconciled. May those who hate find peace and those who are sad find joy. May those who grieve be consoled and those who are sick be healed. May those in distress find comfort and those who repent be humbled. May the prophets be remembered, the apostles honored, and all the martyrs crowned. And may the confessors exult and all the angels rejoice. May your divinity be praised and your Trinity be honored, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and always and forever. We offer you, O Lord, this sacrifice, the memorial of your passion, crucifixion, death, and resurrection for your church throughout the world. She is founded upon your hope, is mindful of your salvation, and awaits your kingdom. We offer it for the bishops of the true faith. Grant them the wisdom and knowledge that comes from you, and make them worthy to proclaim your kingdom, especially Francis, the Pope of Rome, Bishop Peter, our Patriarch of Antioch, and Gregory John, our Bishop. May all the shepherds of the Church sanctify their days by caring, in fear and in justice, for your people that you have entrusted to them. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the priests and deacons here and everywhere who serve diligently and are vigilant over their flock. May they receive their reward. Remember those who have taken vows of chastity and holiness, who keep their bodies and thoughts pure, that they may triumph in their efforts.
We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, our civil leaders who love you, and all those whom you wish to govern us. Strengthen and assist them so that we may live in peace under their leadership. Crown them with true faith and good work.
We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the children of the church, redeemed by your passion and given life by your death. For they share in your resurrection, those who are far and those who are near, those who are weak and those who are strong. Remember those who have presented these offerings upon your holy altar and accept them on your heavenly altar. Hear their just requests, and in exchange for their earthly gifts, grant them the gifts of heaven.
We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, in your grace, those whom we have remembered and those whom we have not. In your mercy, have compassion on them. Remember especially those in distress who have experienced hardship, the poor, the weak, and the grieving, those in exile, captives and prisoners, the oppressed, outcasts and the dejected, orphans and widows. Remember those bound by the chains of sin and subjected to various passions. Through your body and blood, may their sins be forgiven, their faults be pardoned, their weaknesses be cured, and their wounds be healed.
We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, in your great mercy, our fathers and patriarchs, the teachers of your holy church, who were pleasing to you from the beginning. By the glorious light of their teaching, they brought people back from the darkness of ignorance to the true light of the Holy Gospel, and they fought to preserve the integrity of the true faith. Through their holy prayers, grant peace to your churches, monasteries, and convents. Put an end to all wars and strife throughout the world.
We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, all your saints, especially Mary, the Holy and Ever-Virgin Mother of God, the prophets, apostles, martyrs, confessors, and all who profess the Trinity in true faith. through their holy prayers and petition, look upon us with eyes of compassion, and may your calming and pleasant face shine upon us. Make us worthy to share in their reward and their inheritance, and may their shadow be a shelter of protection for us on the fearful day of judgment. We pray to you, O Lord.
The sweetness of your compassion, receive the souls of our brothers and sisters, the children of baptism, who have gone to you in the true faith from this world of darkness, especially those for whom the sacrifice is offered. May the mystery of your body and blood be a pledge of life for them, a fire that consumes all sins, and a burning coal that destroys transgressions. In your mercy, grant them the rest and dwellings of light and joy in the heavenly Jerusalem. O lover of all people, grant us life, abundant blessings and mercy, and forgive our sins and theirs.
Grant rest, O God, to the departed, and forgive the sins we have committed, with no doubtful
mind. O Lord, do not deprive us of your mercy, but keep us in the palm of your hand, lest we fall and go astray, so that we may walk on your paths, follow your ways, and do your will. Forgive us and our departed, and pardon all sins and transgressions, hidden and seen, committed with or without full knowledge. Make us worthy of a faithful Christian death that is pleasing to you, and join us to your righteous ones and to those who have done your will, that in us and in all things your blessed name may be glorified with the name of our Lord Jesus Christ and of your living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
As it was,
and sanctify us by your holy gifts. May you dwell among us that we may be secure. May your peace live within our hearts, your faith abide in our consciences, and your cross be a true sign of protection for your church. May our tongues proclaim your truth and repeat your holy prayer, and our lips pour forth glorious thanks to you, that with you we dare to call the Father, Abba, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done,
on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom of God and the glory of God. O Lord,
do not lead us, your lowly children, into temptation, but deliver us from all evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Amen.
Shlomo lekulchunam. O Lord, we have approached your holy altar, the source of divine gifts. May we share in your holy mysteries and join the assembly of those who glorify you, that we may raise glory to you now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the Most Holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
Amen.
Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity.
One Holy Father, one Holy Son, one Holy Spirit, blessed be the name of the Lord, for He is one in heaven and on earth, to Him be glory forever.
Make us worthy, O Lord God, so that our bodies may be sanctified by your holy blood,
and our souls purified by your forgiving blood.
May our communion be for the forgiveness of our sins and for new life.
O Lord our God, to you be glory forever.
Oh.
Again and again we thank you, O Lord, and we raise glory to you for giving us your body to eat and your living blood to drink. O lover of all people, have mercy on us.
Have mercy on us, O Lord.
We thank you, O God, Father of great mercy, and we praise and glorify you for having made us worthy of your holy banquet and of sharing in your life-giving mysteries. We implore you, do not condemn us on that fearful day, but deliver us from all shame and disgrace, that we may join the assembly of your saints, so that with them and among them, we may raise glory to you, to your only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Shlomo el Kurkun.
Amen.
O Christ, the King of Glory, we entrust our lives to you, knowing that you will take care of our needs. Help the elderly with your mighty power, and restrain the young with your guidance. Nurture children and instruct them in your divine teaching, and sign each one of us with your victorious cross. To you be glory, with your Father and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
So, when I left my parish in Idaho in 1995, that year we had had 54 baby baptisms throughout the 12 months. I was always in admiration of the mothers who brought life into the world. They really are miracle workers. But I'm even more in admiration now for those who have brought life into the world as we begin to descend in a spiral of a culture of death. And so there may have been 54 babies in 1995, 94, which was pretty glorious. But it looks even more glorious now when we have a generation and a culture that seems to scorn life. So on a day in which we commemorate mothers, I can only applaud and thank all of you women who have brought life into the world. As I said, you are miracle workers. And what you've accomplished is a sign of hope, the future, and a gift. Because you bring this life into the world, you always give us a future. The fathers also, but we'll talk about dads next month. But the mothers have this establishment and a foundation. And so we're going to do, I want to call down the greatest blessings possible, not only of gratitude, but in thanksgiving, but also blessings upon you, all the mothers, and the mothers-to-be. So we're going to use the special solemn blessing, which is on page 920, I think. Let me see here. We have solemn prayers on 920, page 920, which we'll use for our solemn final blessing. And after each of the invocations that you have in the middle of page 920, as we do in the Maronite tradition, you're to say amen after each of them. The forgiveness of sinners, amen. To the health of the sick, amen. All right, so this will be our final blessing then of gratitude towards you mothers, and you mothers to be. Because again, as I said, you give us hope, and we marveled in our own generation at the miracles that you accomplish. So, please stand and we'll do our final blessing. O Lord God, you are good, merciful, and compassionate. You accepted the sacrifices and offerings of Abel, your humble one, Abraham, your friend, Melchizedek, your servant, and all the patriarchs of old. Then you accepted the offerings of the apostles, the fathers of the church, the martyrs, and those who believed in your name and who pleased you by their works. Now, O Lord, in your mercy and compassion, receive this holy sacrifice that we have offered, and through it grant to us forgiveness to sinners,
Amen.
Health to the sick,
Amen.
Hope to the brokenhearted,
Amen.
Consolation to the grieving,
Amen.
Rest to the departed,
Amen.
Freedom to captives,
Amen.
Companionship to travelers,
Amen.
Guidance to those who are far,
Amen.
And protection to those who are near,
Amen.
And grace and consolation to the mothers who have brought life into this world.
Amen.
O Lord, may your merciful right hand bless this country, this place, and those who live here and who believe in your name. Keep them from times of trouble and from deep sorrow. Deliver them from dangerous temptations and whatever might harm their bodies and endanger their souls. Guide our civil leaders who believe in your holy name. Forgive my sins and the sins of this community through the intercession of Our Lady, the Mother of the Light, Saint John the Baptist, and all the saints.
Amen.
Move in peace over the altar, God. Let your church and peace be in and receive your beautiful prayers and thoughts. Sins and salvation. Move in peace.